My friend, if you are a rock or metal guitar player just like me, chances are you're quite frustrated on your guitar journey right now. Because there's not a lot of great and very helpful material out there online. You go from video to video and you try to piece this gigantic puzzle together. So I made this completely free structured online course for you. So in this extremely valuable free video, I will take you through the 5 steps that make me the rock and metal guitar player I am today. Just one very important thing before we start with this free course. This is essentially just a very small preview of what awaits you inside my online guitar academy on patreon.com/burn. Over there you instantly get access to 12 full guitar technique courses, 5 incredibly helpful music theory courses, 4 home recording courses that will show you how to professionally record guitar and music at home, and there's even a very limited personal coaching tier. With this one you get my personal help and assistance on your guitar journey, along with an awesome personalized practice plan that suits your goals. We just opened up some new limited slots for this month. Everything was basically sold out a couple of days ago. So we are accepting some limited new students right now. Just click the link in the description or in the first comment down below to see if there's still some space for you. I'm waiting for you in my online guitar academy on Patreon, but for now, let's start the free course. Picking technique. So for today's video, I'd like to revisit the 5 best beginner alternate picking exercises that really helped me out a lot in the beginning. So let's start practicing together right away. So to answer one of the most frequently asked questions right away, what kind of picks am I working with? Right now I'm playing these Jazz 3 size picks. Those are the Dunlop Max Grip series, but actually any kind of Jazz 3 size pick works great for me. I like a rough surface. Like with this Max Grip surface, you won't lose your pick that easily when you have really sweaty hands on stage. So that is something that I like to go for concerning guitar picks, the Jazz 3 size, those small picks, since they give me the most amount of control. And when it comes to the picking motion itself, you will see that I always have my wrist attached to the guitar in some way, so my wrist is never floating around like that, for example. I know that a lot of guitar players are getting great results out of a technique like this, but I feel like I always have to be in touch with the guitar, and my wrist is always kind of placed on the bridge, not always on the strings, because that way I would always mute the strings like that, but it is placed right here. So I always feel that connection to the instrument, and I wouldn't really get tight and controlled results if I would play like that, if my right hand wasn't attached to the guitar at all. So even when I'm just strumming or arpeggiating chords, my hand is also resting on the guitar like that, so it never looks like that, for example. Another thing that you can probably observe is that the movement is always quite small and relaxed. I'm never using my entire arm to pick like that. So staying relaxed is actually quite important for me, since I want to play fast and tricky sections. That's what I enjoy playing. And I also want that to sound good with a clean sound or with a crunch sound or an acoustic guitar. And that wouldn't really be possible if the motion looked something like that. That sounds pretty terrible. And it always seems like using more force, playing with more power, is like a shortcut to playing faster, but that's really not the case. So even when I'm speeding things up, I still want to make sure to be relaxed, not to use my entire arm like that. The motion is still mainly coming from my wrist. When I'm playing faster, I'm using a little bit more of my arm, but it never looks like that, and it never feels exhausting, or I never feel any pain in my wrist or any burning sensation in my arm. And one more thing that you probably noticed already as well, I'm forming a fist when I'm playing, so it doesn't look like that. I'm not stretching out my fingers and they are not kind of flopping around like that when I'm playing. And as soon as I started trying that out, I got much, much better results, and it kind of suddenly became much easier to control the amount of notes that I was playing. So I think we are more than ready to look at the first exercise right now. This is my very first alternate picking exercise that I ever worked on, that I want to show you today as number 1 as well. So with this one we're actually working on 2 different patterns already. If you want to slow it down even more, you can just isolate those 2 patterns and work on them individually. For the first one, we are playing downstroke, upstroke, downstroke. So 8th note, 8th note, and then a quarter note. So the full pattern, the first pattern would be, And for the second pattern, we're turning it around and we're starting with the quarter note and we're playing the two eighth notes after that. So that one starts with the downstroke of the quarter note, then downstroke, upstroke. So the entire pattern would be. That sounds simple enough, but it's really tricky to play it perfectly accurate to a click. And as always, I want you to practice this to a metronome. So please don't just sit at home with your guitar and your amplifier and go like that. Because that doesn't really make any sense if you don't have any pulse. You also want to work on your timing and rhythm right here, and that is the exact reason why I recorded some video play-alongs for you once again. You can find the tabs, guitar profiles and video play-alongs for all of those exercises I will show you today on patreon.com/Bernd. When you download those video play-alongs after joining my Shred Guitar community over there today, you can start practicing together with me in every single practice routine, so you have a direct reference of my technique and can mimic what's going on screen. And I think that is always very helpful, aside from timing your practice routines much more effectively when you have files like that. So to sum it up, let's listen to the first exercise again once more. Now let's move to the second and much harder exercise. For this one, we're working with the continuous alternate picking motion already. So we're always playing downstroke, upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, and so on. And we're switching from eighth notes to 16th notes. So we're playing one measure of eighth notes and one measure of 16th notes. Here's how that sounds like. So once again, that might not sound too hard, but it's really challenging to do this very accurately when you're playing to the click by yourself, because the main challenge right here is that we want to switch from eighth notes to 16th notes without any kind of period in between where you're searching for the correct note value and where you're adapting to the new group. You have to be in time right after you switch to that new group. So when you practice this one to a click, the click will be counting quarter notes for you. So for the eighth notes, you're playing two notes per click. So one, two, three, four. And for the 16th notes, that is the first really, really big challenge when you're getting into alternate picking, you're playing four notes per beat. So one, two, three, four, and so on. So when you speed it up a bit, you're playing one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Or when you slow it down, one, two, three, four. And as you can see, playing that slowly is pretty tough because you always tend to play a bit too fast since you're thinking, wow, the 16th notes are coming up now. Those are the faster notes, so I have to play faster. And most of the time you actually have to play laid back and to focus on the click, because it's difficult to play those 16th notes in time since you have to play four notes on each click. So it takes quite a while until the next click is coming. And usually with my students and also with myself, when I'm playing faster stuff, I tend to come in a little bit early. So that is what I want you to pay attention to. This is a great exercise for your timing and it really, really helps with that. Now, since we worked quite a lot with just the open E string for the first exercises, I think we should involve our left hand right now, and we will also look at a new note value at triplets, eighth note triplets to be precise. So for this third exercise, we are taking the principle of the previous exercise where we are switching between different note groups. But this time we are also involving our left hand and we are switching from eighth note triplets to eighth notes. So on every beat of the metronome in the first measure, I'm playing three notes. And then in the second measure, I'm only playing two notes on each beat. So this is the exercise performed much slower and also how I'm counting it in my head to stay in time. One thing that you might have noticed with all the exercises so far is that I prefer to mute the notes so I can hear the accents that I'm performing a little bit better. Because for me, that way it's easier to hear if I'm playing in time than playing like that. That way I can really hear those picking strokes and make sure to play in time, but of course it's also great to switch that up to work with palm muted notes and with open notes in your practice routine. So exercise 2 and 3 are quite similar. For exercise 2 we are switching between 8th notes and 16th notes, and for exercise number 3 we are switching between 8th notes and 8th note triplets. Let's look at two more advanced workouts right now to challenge you a bit. Here's workout number 4. For this one we want to involve our left hand much more, so this is a great warm-up exercise as well for your right hand and for your left hand. And we're essentially playing the chromatic scale, simply every single note, and I'm limiting it to up to the 12th fret, so we're only playing in this area, and we're playing every single note ascending, and then we're descending, and here's what that sounds like. So the main challenge and also benefit with that exercise is working on hand synchronization, since we're playing a different note on every single picking stroke. So whenever a down or up stroke doesn't align with the right note with your left hand, or you're hitting the string while you're switching to the next note, your brain kind of realizes, okay, something went wrong there, and the more you work on that, the better the synchronization between your hands will be. The next tricky thing is that we have to constantly jump between different positions right here, and from a technical and especially left hand technique point of view, the main goal with this exercise would be hiding those transitions from every single position, because it should sound like a piano player just ascending and descending on the piano. The listener shouldn't really hear that you constantly have to switch to a new position, that you're jumping a semitone up with every single repetition of the exercise. So we don't want it to sound like that, for example. Those were some very sloppy transitions between the positions. I was kind of sliding into the next one and I wasn't really on time. We want to connect all of those different position switches like that, for example. So although I was starting to play a bit faster right here, you couldn't really hear me switching between those different positions like that. Like that, it sounds really connected, and that's the main goal when you're practicing this. So start really, really slow. As far as the right hand is concerned, it's just a continuous down and up motion. So down stroke, upstroke, and so on. In the tabs and guitar profiles on Patreon, I wrote it down as an exercise in 16th notes. Since it's a repeating pattern of 4 notes that is constantly repeated, so you always have a new pattern on every single quarter note when you play to the click. But you can also choose to work with 8th notes right here, and to make it really, really slow, the most important thing is the clean execution of the exercise and not working on tempo and speed right away. So since that one is quite challenging, let's take a listen once again before we move to the final exercise for today. Alright, and now let's check out the final workout. This one is quite challenging for your right hand once again, because you're introduced to the first very advanced topic actually, called string skipping. So right now we are skipping between the A and the G string, and we don't want to hit the D string in between. And this is how the exercise looks like. So for this exercise I'm just playing an octave interval, so D in that case, similar to the power chord, the perfect fifth. I'm sure you're familiar with that one. We're just leaving out the middle note, so we are playing the same note twice, D, on the fifth fret on the A string and on the seventh fret on the G string. And we are playing two strokes for both positions, so downstroke, upstroke, and then we have to jump to the next string, downstroke, upstroke, and then we have to jump back. And that is of course quite challenging, because as I mentioned, we don't want to hit the D string in the middle. So it should sound something like that. Downstroke, upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, downstroke, upstroke, and we don't want to hit the string right in between. And as you speed that up and as you practice more, you will see that that is quite challenging, but it's the foundation for some really cool licks in the future where you can use those string skipping skills to avoid playing scale positions up and down all the time and to break out of that, to play really interesting phrases like that, for example. Today I'd like to show you 6 essential patterns that you absolutely need in your repertoire. These are the perfect building blocks for fast and really exciting licks. After working on these individual patterns, I also want to show you a really cool guitar solo exercise that I put together for this lesson. This really special alternate picking shred workout puts together all those building blocks, and that's the perfect workout for you in case you want to learn how to shred as fast as possible. So before we check out the really cool alternate picking guitar solo exercise that I put together for you that is based on all those individual building blocks, we should check out each important pattern in detail. Let's start out with a basic but quite popular one. Quick disclaimer, you can use all of today's patterns in any kind of scale you want, but let's focus on the really popular scale of A minor today, also in its most popular position on the fretboard, starting from A on the 5th fret on the low E string, since most of you guys and girls will be familiar with that fingering. So just to show you the basic idea with today's patterns, we're alternating between the low E and the A string. Once you've familiarized yourself with the picking pattern and once your hands are synchronized, you can extend them, of course, to all the rest of the strings. So with this first pattern, the idea is relatively simple. You're working with triplets, since you're playing a 3-note per string scale that comes in very handy. And you're just playing the scale position up on 2 strings, or just like I demonstrated, on all strings, or 4 strings, or as many strings as you want. And this one will get much more interesting as soon as we combine it with different patterns. Remember that all of those patterns are just building blocks. And the exciting part with all this starts when we start to mix and match all of those patterns together. I think you will start to see the great potential with all of this when we keep moving. Let's check out the second pattern now. This one already sounds and looks quite different. We're still ascending in the scale, but then we're just playing 1 note on the A string before we return to the low E string. With that one, I want you to especially pay attention to the familiar topic of the flying pinky finger once again. It's actually very common to see it played like this. And that really stands in the way of speeding up this pattern, because it's very hard to get a fast and controlled motion when your left hand is working like that. So focus on keeping your hands as close to the fretboard as possible with that one. And as a quick demonstration to spice things up, the magic already starts to happen when we combine pattern 1 with pattern number 2. We will check out really cool and more practical licks like that one a bit later with the guitar solo part that I prepared for today. But all I did to spontaneously get that lick was combining pattern 1 with pattern number 2. So working with building blocks like that is a great way for coming up with fast and really intense shred licks on the fly. Let's move to 16th notes and check out pattern number 3 right now. So for this one, we're essentially cycling between 2 strings, between the low E and the A string, moving back and forth. And the really cool detail for this one is that we end up with an odd number of notes on each string. We start out with 3 notes on the low E string, then we have 5 notes on the A string, 5 notes once again on the low E string, and then 3 notes on the A string before the pattern would repeat in the next measure. So this one has a really cool progressive sound to it, in case that's what you're looking for. As always, you can download the tabs, guitar profiles, backing tracks and video play-alongs for this lesson on patreon.com/Bernd. You're more than welcome to practice all of this together with me in your next practice routine with the special video play-alongs that are recorded for the guitar solo exercise. And obviously it's also much more fun to work on all those individual patterns with the backing tracks I made especially for you. This is also the place where you can send me personal messages in case you have any questions about your technique or any kind of theory topics or equipment, anything like that. So I'm really looking forward to getting in touch with you as soon as you join us over there. Let's move on to pattern number 4 now. This one is a bit challenging, but really cool, and I'd love to hear it more often out there. For this one, we're essentially highlighting one note, D, on the 5th fret on the A string by circling it with lower notes on the low E string. Some players actually prefer to play this pattern starting with an upstroke on the A string. That also makes sense, of course. It's the same as if we would start picking pattern number 2 on the 4th note instead of the 1st note. But I recommend practicing both approaches because it's also really cool to have that downstroke on the 1st note to really accent that one. Before we move to the final two really cool patterns and the awesome guitar solo exercise that I prepared for you today, I have to show you the shocking graph once again. Sadly, nothing has changed so far. Still around 70% of you guys and girls watching these videos are not subscribed to the channel yet. That means you sadly keep missing tons of really helpful videos like that one, and you're not a real part of our awesome guitar community here on YouTube yet. So make sure to change that right now by subscribing, that's the best way of staying updated. Let's work on pattern number 5 right now. This one is really cool because we don't always want to start out with the lowest note in the scale or with the root note even. So to change things up, we're starting with the highest note on each string for the 3 note per string positions. And to make it even more interesting, we're working with odd note groupings once again in 16th notes. Leave a like to let me know if you recognize this one from one of the most popular alternate picking workouts we looked at so far. So that one is directly inspired by this really cool picking workout. Let's finish things off with one of my absolute favorites, picking pattern number 6. So this one is unique because we have two different ideas for each string. So I think we're quite familiar with the first one by now. But for the A string, we're doing something different. And essentially combining two ideas in one pattern results in a really cool building block that you can use. Now that we successfully discussed all 6 patterns in great detail, let's talk about how to practice them in an effective and musical way. As I mentioned in the beginning, the real magic starts to happen, of course, when we start to combine, mix and match all of those different building blocks. So to provide something extra special for today's video, I came up with a really cool alternate picking guitar solo exercise. This one is really fun to play and it combines all sorts of really cool ideas and patterns. Let's check it out together in the original tempo of 120 beats per minute. So this special workout is really cool and effective since it features mid-tempo picking, the 16th notes at 120 beats per minute. And you're also working on the really fast motion with the 16th note triplets. I really recommend learning this one since it's a lot of fun to play and a great workout for your picking technique and also for your left hand. You can download video play-along files in much slower tempos I recorded for you on patreon.com/Bernd. With these files you can practice it slowly together with me until you're able to play it at the original tempo. Stop! Today's video is not about shredding at all. I know, it's crazy. Yes, when I started out, I was immediately drawn to those challenging technique exercises we talk about weekly on this channel today. But I actually neglected a couple of really important workouts at the beginning of my guitar journey. And I definitely paid the price for that later because I basically had to restructure my entire technique from scratch to get to the point where I'm at right now. If you're subscribed and part of our YouTube community for a while now, you know about this journey and a lot of time was wasted. And all of that really tedious extra work and lost time is exactly what I want to save you from with my work that I do on this channel. So this video is not about your typical beginner spider exercises, note location exercises, or anything else you've heard about millions of times already. It's about picking technique and fretting hand technique basics that constantly get overlooked by thousands of players. So please learn from my mistakes today as we check out 3 exercises I wish I knew as a beginner guitarist.
From easy to hard.
Today's exercises deal with one of the biggest technique problems I've seen with myself over the last couple of years and with pretty much all of my students. Really unlocking your wrist when you're playing for a super effective picking motion instead of working with your elbow or even with a full arm motion like that. And today's video is also about one of the biggest fretting hand technique mistakes or frustrations, muting the other strings while you're playing and also avoiding that nasty unwanted noise when you're playing with distortion especially. Now when you play fast for the very first time, you will actually identify this as the fastest way to success. I hope I don't break any strings. So just pushing really, really hard with your elbow or with your entire arm even. But as you're getting better and after breaking a couple of strings, you will also realize that you're generating tons of unwanted noise because you're constantly touching all the other surrounding strings when you're playing like that. You can switch between the strings correctly. String skipping is basically impossible because you're constantly stuck between the strings if you don't use your wrist. And as you heard with all the bad examples I tried to demonstrate, you always sound really aggressive and stiff. So you don't really have a way of introducing dynamics into your playing. It's always this huge and super aggressive motion that probably doesn't fit every single piece of music. So instead of going for those classic three note per string workouts as a beginner right away or for sweep picking even, I wish I worked on something like this much earlier. So that might look quite easy and harmless compared to all the other insane stuff we looked at recently. But trust me, it's actually not. This exercise is all about timing, mid-tempo alternate picking with wrist motion, string skipping and fretting hand muting. So quite a lot of things to keep in mind. So the reason why I love to recommend workouts like this is because you basically can't play them with that kind of stiff full arm or elbow motion. That sounds pretty bad. This only works if you're loose and relaxed. As you can see, the motion is coming from my wrist when I'm playing and I focus on transitioning fluidly between the strings. Let's do it a bit faster. So playing something like that as a warm-up for a couple of minutes will do wonders for your wrist and for your picking hand in general. This is also the most important tempo zone that is often neglected in practice routines. A lot of my students got the shred or sweep picking basics down, but struggle immensely with playing easy material, tight and controlled at tempos around 120 beats per minute. Because they either practice really slow to learn a new workout or really fast to push their skills, when in fact the area in between is needed the most in a practical context. When you're actually playing music, which directly leads us to the next and even more important exercise. Okay, so at this point I should probably say around 70% of the awesome people watching these videos are not subscribed to this channel yet, and they sadly keep missing a lot of exercises and really cool videos that way. But I will say something different today. 30% of you awesome people watching my content are already subscribed, so thanks a lot for being part of this journey of unlocking the ultimate guitar technique and theory secrets. But let's keep inviting the others to the party, maybe they will join us on our epic and awesome quest. Alright, so exercise 2 is a bit harder already. This one takes the string skipping and string transitioning concept to the next level with a really awesome sounding arpeggio riff. Check it out. So when you play this one for the first time, you will realize that it's actually quite hard to hit the right strings when you're alternate picking like this. And once again, this is an awesome exercise because it's pretty much impossible to play this with an elbow motion or with a full arm motion. That makes your life much, much harder in this case. So another really awesome workout to get rid of bad picking technique habits. This is the sound you want when you speed it up a bit more. So a really cool and quite musical workout with those arpeggios for your picking hand technique. But maybe you've seen it already, your fretting hand also has to work really hard with those shapes to keep the notes from overlapping. As you can see when I'm playing the exercise, I focus on economy of motion, so I keep my fingers close to the fretboard. But I also don't curl my fingers as much as I usually do to make sure to block any strings or notes ringing through. This obviously also helps a lot with avoiding unwanted noise when I'm playing this fast with distortion. So I highly suggest adding this one to your practice routine in case you want to work on your wrist motion and on your string muting skills with your fretting hand. As always, you can download the exercise video play-alongs in different tempos, backing tracks, guitar profiles and PDF tabs on patreon.com/bernd. I upload extremely helpful files like this for every single weekly YouTube video that I publish, and additional in-depth guitar courses are also added for you at least once a month over there. So click the link in the description or in the first comment below to join our awesome community of over 4,000 dedicated players today. Let's work on your guitar skills together from now on. So the third exercise concept I wish I worked on much, much earlier is something that is completely ignored by the majority of rock and metal guitar players. Working on special patterns like the one I'm about to show you would have unlocked my wrist much, much sooner on the journey. So what is this third and probably most difficult topic all about? As you know, we're mainly connected to the guitar because the picking hand wrist is resting on the bridge in most cases to quickly switch between palm muted and open notes like that. So resting your picking hand on the bridge like that is the most common way of playing in this genre, and I can absolutely recommend it. But as you know by now, this exact style of playing often results in that elbow or full arm motion. I was surprised at how difficult it was for me to play basic funk patterns, although I was already getting into shredding a couple of years ago. And it was even kind of challenging to play basic strumming patterns on acoustic guitar and really staying in time. But really awesome exercises like this one helped me with eliminating those inconsistencies quickly. So this is the basic alternate picking motion. But for these rhythm patterns, you're essentially placing your hand and arm like this instead. So your wrist is not resting on the bridge, it's floating in the air like that. And that way, this kind of motion comes very natural. And in my experience, it works much better than trying to play funk patterns like that or even like that. That's a bit too crazy, I guess. So let's check out this motion in action once again and see this pattern performed a bit faster. That feels so much better already, and I'm really warmed up by now. So this is not just about becoming a funk guitar player. If you don't enjoy this kind of music, it's about getting that wrist unlocked and ready for any playing style. So if you're as guilty as I am when it comes to constantly ignoring incredibly powerful and important workouts like this, always going for the shiny, crazy stuff instead all the time, make sure to get all of your practice files for this lesson on Patreon today and start eliminating those technique blind spots right away. I did some research. Turns out a lot of the awesome people subscribed to this channel are into metal. I wonder why. Seems kind of random, right? Okay, no, it totally makes sense. So since most rock and metal guitar players or instrumentalists of any kind are self-taught and naturally drawn to technique and not so much to music theory, I want to provide a structured theory guide especially aimed at rock and metal enthusiasts, because I know you probably don't want to learn super advanced chords that you will actually never use. You don't want to learn how to read complex sheet music, and you don't want to spend hours on reharmonizing jazz tunes. You only want to learn what you absolutely need in order to play, compose and understand the music that you love. So here are the 8 steps that I would follow if I had to do this all over again. Returning viewers of this channel have heard me talk about this quite a lot. There is no way around this. You got to have good or at least decent fretboard visualization skills. So unsurprisingly, my recommended first step is seeing the notes on the fretboard as you're playing, at least on the lowest 3 strings in your preferred tuning. Thinking in octaves will unlock the notes on the higher strings for you easily as soon as you master this basic foundation. If you need some more help with this, and if you still have some blind spots across the neck, I added all the resources and exercises that you need in the description of this video, along with my fretboard Mastery online course on Patreon. That one will fix this annoying problem for you in a matter of days. Most metal riffs are based on intervals. You all know the legendary power chord. But you probably came across other intervals as well. And the thing is, you can't mix and match those intervals, so those small chords, together randomly. Some combinations simply sound better than others. And to save yourself from countless hours of trial and error when you're writing riffs, you should at least study the name, sound and function of each interval. Just practice and memorize them on the guitar like this. And I additionally recommend getting an ear training app on your phone that teaches you to identify the intervals quickly just by hearing them. When you start doing that on the train or on the subway to work, or yes, on the toilet instead of checking TikTok, you will be light years ahead as a musician and guitarist in just a couple of weeks. Up next, I have a riddle for you. What is something that most pop songwriters and instrumentalists can do and most metal guitarists can't? No, it's not making money. It's about knowing which chords go into which key. But hold up, I know what you're thinking.
I don't want to write ballads with campfire chords. I want to write riffs that snap necks and leads that melt faces.
That's fine, me too. But even when you're working with single note riffs, with intervals, or even with high speed shredding arpeggios, you absolutely have to know the chords in the key that you're actually playing in. So to do the bare minimum of theory studying when it comes to this, you should at least memorize the chords on each scale degree of natural major and minor. Yes, you will probably need minor much more. That way you can finally eliminate the annoying guesswork of always looking for the right next chord for your epic chorus riff, for example. As soon as you memorized all the chords on each scale degree in major and minor, you should learn about cadences. Remember how I said some interval combinations sound better than others? Well, even if you work with the right notes in your key, some cadences sound more catchy or simply better than others. So by learning about the most commonly used cadences in songwriting, starting in the era of classical music of course, and then going all the way into modern pop and rock music, you will instantly get a better feeling for writing amazing hooks and memorable riffs instead of always sounding almost great. I actually did some research on that when I worked on the metal song for David Hasselhoff. And the track has performed pretty good so far since the release. At one point, you probably want to dive into the world of progressive metal or modern metal or djent. You will notice that a lot of acts in these genres work with odd meters, so something like 7-8, 5-4 or even 17-8, like the Dream Theater song that actually won a Grammy this year. In order to enter this world yourself, you definitely need a solid foundation when it comes to rhythm. So music theory-wise, the bare minimum is knowing the names of all the most common note values and being able to switch between them on your instrument. But I can't recommend enough also learning how to count in odd meters. Aside from better timing and rhythm skills as a guitar player, you will also benefit by naturally coming up with ideas in odd time signatures after practicing them for a while. The big and seemingly well-kept secret when it comes to all of this is just dissecting big and scary looking meters into smaller groups. So instead of always counting 7-8 like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, try to identify smaller groups in the riffs and rhythms that you're hearing. For example, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, and so on. As soon as you start hearing those smaller groups in odd meter compositions, you will have a much easier time with mastering them. If you're looking for a cool practical example, I posted a killer riff section earlier this week that switches from 5-4 to 4-4 and then to 6-4. Writing this, I didn't even notice that I was working with an odd meter, because by actively working on that, I got very used to thinking outside of 4-4. So if you're looking for some new and exciting guitar music and also some inspiration when it comes to odd meters, make sure to check out the full song on Spotify. I added the link below. And also follow me over there, because I know you're always looking for something new and cool to listen to when you open the app. I think that you might like what I have for you over there. So the next topic is all about scales. I don't know about you, but I still remember my early metal songwriting days, always looking up cool sounding exotic scales on the internet. Then after learning one scale position, immediately trying them out over my music and riffs, and then being very disappointed because none of these scales actually worked over my songs.
Waste of time.
In case this happens to you as well, remember what we talked about in step 3. This was all about learning what chords actually go into a key. And as you can see right here, the scale is actually always the foundation of your composition. And the chords are actually all derived from the notes of the underlying scale. So if you want to work with more interesting scales like harmonic minor, melodic minor, Phrygian dominant, or
super Locrian,
please remember that you should use them as a foundation for your music and riffs as well. Otherwise, it might not really work. Except if your riffs look like this. If you're always just playing the lowest note of your instrument, you got plenty of freedom when it comes to your scale choices. One of the absolute biggest complaints I keep hearing from students when it comes to guitar solos is that it's quite hard to break out of the pentatonic scale or out of any other scale, and that a lot of metal players feel like they're constantly working with the same ideas and licks all the time. So an easy quick fix to escape this monotony is learning how arpeggios and triads really work. Those are not just some shapes to memorize until you can play them at the speed of light with sweep picking. You can actually melodically accent chord changes easily when you're improvising. That often results in this cool neoclassical symphonic metal guitar sound. But all of this only works when you understand when to use which arpeggio. Once again, the recommended bare minimum effort is studying one shape for major, one for minor, one for augmented, and one for diminished. That will make it possible for you to start experimenting with arpeggios. And the next recommended step is studying the interval structure of seventh arpeggios, because that way you can build your own shapes on the fly and you don't always have to rely on the one or two shapes that you have memorized. If you want to learn how to actually practice everything I talk about in this video, I highly recommend checking out the new Intermediate Music Theory course on Patreon. That's a 30-day learning program I put together especially for rock and metal guitar players, so it's exactly what you need to finally get rid of those annoying music theory blind spots. If all of this is interesting for you, make sure to join the world's biggest guitar community on Patreon by clicking the link down below. But before you go, here's one more topic I recommend doing every single day to complete your Metal Theory Essentials training. This one might shock you a bit. Try to play and improvise over non-metal music. So here's the thing, I will never be the best blues, Latin, or jazz player, simply because I'm not in love or extremely passionate about those styles of music. But I learned so much, theory and also technique-wise, from studying jazz guitar at the conservatory, from playing and jamming with blues bands, or from playing on stage with Latin or even huge pop bands. And my metal playing and especially my songwriting got so much better and more diverse from these experiences. So that's just a friendly personal tip. I think it's a big mistake to limit yourself to just playing and practicing metal all the time. So please let me know about your current relationship status with music theory at the moment down in the comments.
It's complicated.
Make sure to subscribe right now to finally become a real part of our guitar community here on YouTube.
Yes, now you're finally one of us.
And download the brand new Theory course on Patreon to finally conquer this topic once and for all. That is what unlocked this fluid sweep picking motion for me, so that's when it clicked after doing that for a while. All right, my friends, today I would like to talk to you about sweep picking. Aside from showing you some exercises and tricks that unlock this traditional neoclassical sounding sweep picking approach for me, I'm also quite excited to show you the evolution of my sweep picking licks and style, so how I'm actually doing some of the more modern stuff that you can hear and listen to on this channel. Also on my most recent instrumental guitar album Elevation, of course. First of all, this is the very common shape that I started out with. So out of all the different arpeggios, why exactly this one? That was simply the opening arpeggio to a quite iconic section of the coolest and most technical guitar song that everybody wanted to learn back when I started out. Stab Wound by these gentlemen over here. Let me know in the comments if you remember this one and if you also gave it a try back then. It was quite a while ago, but I think there was a tap on the 24th fret as well. So if you wanted to be the coolest guy in the entire rehearsal space, you had to be able to play this lick. There are a lot of players out there who just want to learn to sweep because it's hard and it's a great flex. But if you don't have that specific lick, guitar solo or entire piece of music that really motivates you, I think you won't make that much progress because you're just playing the exercises, you don't even enjoy the sound of them. So if you haven't already, make sure to find something that inspires you after watching this video. It's really cool for me to see that a lot of students in the Patreon VIP Facebook group are inspired by the Paganini Caprice that I uploaded 1 year ago. So that relatively easy sweep picking section at the beginning is a great start. Of course, you should start a little bit slower, but with that one, you only have to worry about one sweeping direction, basically. You're sweeping upwards, and you're only connecting two very common shapes with slides. So that's a great challenge, and I'm sure that you can master it with some of the tricks that we will discuss a bit later. If you're an intermediate player, you can also try the next section. That one is a bit harder. Goes something like this, I didn't play it in a long while. In case you would like to learn this cool Paganini neoclassical sweeping sections, as always I made tabs, guitar profiles and exercise play-along videos, especially for you, on Patreon. So don't forget to download them after the lesson so that you finally have some cool sweep picking workouts for your daily routine. Back to my first arpeggio. Sadly, I was a very impatient kid, so I never really sat down with the metronome at the beginning and started very slow. Of course, I wanted to go fast right away, so I actually used this exact arpeggio shape in one of my first songs in the first EP that I recorded in a professional studio, but my sweep picking approach back then was quite sloppy. I will try my best to recreate what I was doing. Yeah, sounds something like that, right? So aside from that idea not exactly being interesting, just moving the same pattern up and down, a semitone, the execution is also very sloppy and it sounds more like a rake, so playing dead notes. So when I listen to this recording nowadays with better trained ears, I can always hear the lowest note of the arpeggio, then a bunch of dead notes, not exactly in time, and then the highest notes of the arpeggio. So I guess the bottom and the high part of the arpeggio were okay already, but in between you have that confusing mess of dead notes, not exactly real note values. So I was kind of cheating my way through the solo. Please don't take this as a good example, but it actually worked. The producer and the other guys told me, wow, that's really cool, it's great that you're sweeping in this guitar solo. But deep down I always knew that it's just a trick. I couldn't really play any advanced and more interesting patterns, for example the intermediate Paganini example we just looked at. With all shapes that I learned, it was always kind of like... So you could hear the lowest note, maybe even the hammer-on, then a confusing mess of dead notes, then the high note, if I was lucky also the pull-off, and then the dead notes again. That doesn't really sound too great. So to move on, at the start I always wondered why I didn't sound like my personal guitar heroes. Whenever they played arpeggios, the sound was really smooth, it didn't sound like they were struggling at all, totally fluid. So that's how I wanted to sound, but that's how I sounded. So I finally chose to commit to this and to practice slow and to a metronome, and here's what made this click for me. I was mostly focusing on simple, short bursts of ascending and descending arpeggios, and my biggest focus was always exactly lining up the first note with the metronome and the last note as well. So for example, 1, 2, 3, 4. So special focus on the first, the lowest, and the last, the highest note. Of course, at the beginning it still sounded something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. So the note on the 1 was perfectly in place, the note on the 4 as well, and in the middle I would have this confusing mess of dead notes. But by setting these anchors in my brain at the start and ending of the arpeggios, the rest of the notes slowly started to fall into place rhythmically. And I think this simply doesn't happen for players that start out with repeating exercises right away, so super long arpeggio etudes. And the second kind of controversial thing that really helped me out is that I was pushing myself way too hard early on with those sloppy fake arpeggios. It actually did have kind of a good side effect to play like this for over a year. I didn't have that very common beginner problem of always attacking the strings individually while I'm playing, like with alternate picking for example. So with a lot of beginner sweepers out there, the picking motion looks like this for quite a while. So attacking all the strings individually with downstrokes and upstrokes because it's simply hardwired into your brain. That's fine if you're playing slow, but if you want to speed it up to this level, it won't be possible anymore with those individual strokes for every string. So this is something I see students struggling with quite frequently, almost every day, in our Patreon Student VIP Facebook group. In case you want some personal feedback on your picking hand technique or on your fretting hand technique, that's the place to be. But in my case, and in retrospect, I have to say I didn't really struggle with this problem a lot because I got used to the relaxed sweeping motion quickly due to the rake or fake arpeggios that I was playing. So for me, it was just a matter of time and patience, really sitting down and getting this tight and clean. So what's your takeaway from this story? Should you also play sloppy fake arpeggios for a year? Probably not, but a big mistake I keep seeing again and again from students is just focusing on perfection, playing really, really slow. So my personal suggestion for you is keep that focus on perfection and playing slow and in time in your routine. But at the end of your sweep picking routine, really challenge yourself and play way too fast and really sloppy. Nobody is listening to you, so there is nothing to be afraid of. Because I really think that is what unlocked this fluid sweep picking motion for me. So that's when it clicked after doing that for a while. And I really don't think that you can get there by just playing two, three or four beats per minute faster every day, starting from, I don't know, 20, 30 beats per minute. And as I promised in the beginning, to end this video, some more modern approaches and sounds concerning sweep picking. What I love to do with my music right now, and you can also hear this on my album Elevation that you can stream on Spotify, the link is in the description, is mixing sweep picking with other techniques like alternate picking, for example. That's not an entirely new concept, but by doing this in certain ways, you get really cool and modern sounding licks, because the traditional shredding approach is always fast alternate picking line, sweep picking section, and then, I don't know, pentatonic shred run, something like that. And by working on licks that quickly combine these different techniques, you get very cool and kind of odd sounding results like this one, for example. So that's just a quick example, but although you heard this A minor arpeggio hundreds of times already, it does sound more interesting right away with those quick alternate picking bursts. So that's the last play along exercise I uploaded for you on Patreon. Also, make sure to practice this one. And please let me know if you would like to see more practical licks like that that combine different techniques like sweep picking and alternate picking. I would love to show you some more special things and tricks that I do in my music to hopefully inspire you for your music. But until then, make sure to leave a like in case you enjoyed this sweep picking video. Don't forget to subscribe so that you don't miss the next one. It would be a shame if you keep missing exercises that would potentially save you years of guitar practice. So click that button right now, you won't regret it. And I will see you again in the next video. Have an awesome day. Bye bye. All right, my friend, you made it all the way until the end of this free course. I'm very proud of you. Don't forget to download all your files and get access to 12 guitar technique courses right away, 5 extremely helpful music theory courses, and 4 home recording courses by joining my online guitar academy on patreon.com/burnt today. As I mentioned at the start, we only have some limited slots for this month, so just click the link down below and see if there's still some space for you. I'll see you on patreon.com/burnt. Thank you so much for watching. Greetings from Vienna, and bye bye.